You missed a second podcast in a row.
Yeah.
It was a good one, too.
I had some vacations.
I know. Well, I'm sure you had a great time on vacation, but you missed such a good conversation. I love this show today. I'm going to start with a question. If the worst of the worst happened, could you get through it? Think about it. Retired First Sergeant Matt Eversmann is the decorated war hero and military leader that Josh Hartnett portrayed in the movie Black Hawk Down. Have you ever seen that?
I have. It's one of my favorites.
It's an excellent movie. Yeah, the movie is the real-life story of what happened in 1993 when the U.S. Army tried to seize two Somali warlords' lieutenants in a daytime raid. Eversmann found himself in charge of Army Rangers and Delta Force soldiers in what's become known as the Battle of Mogadishu. Now, think about this. He was 26 years old.
That's crazy.
Isn't it?
Yeah.
26 years old. They were outnumbered, trapped, targeted by a mob. But with Eversmann's leadership, those who survived what happened in Mogadishu were rescued. Black Hawk Down is their story. It is his story. And more than 25 years later, he is still telling his first-person account of what happened in Somalia to people who want to know how they, too, can be effective leaders. So here's the thing. You don't need the title manager to be a leader. Everyone needs to be a leader. To do your job, you need people to follow you to some degree. Being liked and respected is always a good thing. And it's critical that you know when the worst of the worst happens, you're going to get through it. It's called strategic shock. That's the term for it.
Interesting.
Isn't it? It's that point where you find yourself on the precipice of fight or flight. It's the point where there's no time to point fingers, no time to play the blame game. And in Matt Eversmann's case, it was when that Black Hawk helicopter went down. It was answering that question, are you taking the action? Are you running into the gunfire? Are you tucking tail? So in this Dying to Ask, I had a chance to sit down with Matt Eversmann right before he went on stage in front of almost 700 business leaders. So picture this, Jeff. This is why I'm so bummed you weren't there. It's the two of us, two chairs, an empty conference room, 15 straight minutes. So if you listen, you're going to learn how you can interact differently with people so that you get the results you want. He's going to tell you the number one thing today's leaders are doing wrong, and he's going to tell you why you better get the word average out of your vocabulary. All right, I need a favor.
Okay.
And you owe me this because you weren't there for this conversation. I want to run this one straight. This is about a 15-minute interview. No breaks. I want to run it straight. I want people to hear it from beginning to end because it is powerful.
I think I can do that this one time.
One time?
I will make an exception.
You won't go on vacation again anytime soon either. All right, here is an uninterrupted conversation I had on Dying to Ask with Lieutenant First Sergeant Matt Eversmann. I'm Deirdre Fitzpatrick, and I am obsessed with knowing how people do things. I write the book, they start the company, they go from idea to reality. I call it the art of the follow-through, and I want to know how people go from A to B. This is the Dying to Ask podcast. How should I refer to you?
Matt is fine.
Matt is okay?
Yep, please.
Okay, I don't want to be getting emails from people saying I was disrespectful to you.
Can't believe that. No, listen, we address the whole veteran baby world too. No, Matt is absolutely perfect.
Well, it's very nice to meet you. And after all these years, certainly I was familiar with your story when the movie came out. And I remember the whole situation with Black Hawk Down happened. I was in college. I remember as a young journalist to be seeing all of that and hearing about it. So it's a little bit surreal to me to be talking to you all these years later.
Well, and it's amazing to me too, and not to be like Heckle and Jekyll, that, that was 25 years ago.
Yeah.
Now, that, most people's memory of 25 years. Exactly. You look absolutely spectacular. But, that it had a poignant moment in your life as well, kind of on the other side of the chair here, so to speak. It's like, I always wonder if everyone would remember or do people just forget just yesterday's news kind of thing?
I think it depends on those events. I think we all, growing up, we have those events
yep.
that stick with us at different pivotal times in our life, and they impact you and stick with you in different kinds of ways. And I guess that's why, as a public speaker, your story has taken on such a different life. So how did you get into the public speaking and into talking about leadership after your military experience?
The long answer, not so long, is by complete mistake. At the time when the movie was coming out, I was at the Army War College in Carlisle, Pennsylvania. The Army notoriously has a bad public affairs department, and I'm sorry to say that they're just not normally good. Marine Corps, great. Navy, great. Look at the commercials, all great. But the Army, not so good. So the colonel that I was working for mentioned to a family member about this predicament that I was in, being a real-life soldier on active duty with with a movie being made that he was going to be portrayed in. And that wound up weaseling its way through his volition to reaching out to a couple of speaking agencies. I thought it was just for help with the press, but it turned out to be, hey, we'd like to promote you to come out and tell your story to the business world. And so from there, it sort of domino effect in a good way came out, and here we are 19 years later.
When you started doing that, what did you notice was missing in the business world that your experience in military was supplementing?
That's a phenomenal question, because at the time, all I could rely on was my experience with really great people. And when I mean really great people, dynamic leaders, iconic military leaders. I got Delta guys and Rangers and SEAL Team 6, like you name it. I got to work with all of them. So my assumption was, whatever these folks are doing that I respond to probably ought to work out here. So it was a little hypothetical, like, hey, if you could do this on the battlefield, you could do this at Citibank. Over time, of course, and the more you're out, you realize, end of the day, it's all about people. It's all about people. It doesn't matter whether you're in technology or not. Everything in life is about people. And so those applicable lessons about how we lead, follow, teach, cajole, discipline, elevate our people in the military is absolutely pertinent out here. I think that's really the secret sauce of it all. It's just how do we get the best out of people? And I'm not sure we have learned that lesson that well on the business side. So I'm hoping to evangelize that a little bit.
So when you talk about leadership, what are the qualities that you see maybe lacking in leaders? And how do people become better leaders these days?
I'm sorry I cut you off, because
no, if you're going to tell me it's phenomenal, I'm totally fine being cut off.
No, you're the best. You are absolutely the best. But truly, it's a great question. It seems so simple. First of all, I think sometimes we get confused about leadership as a noun, where somebody is on the masthead, and leadership as a verb, you know, the action. And again, I don't want to dumb it down and be insulting, but, you know, we talk about the business leader as the CEO or someone in the C-suite, and I'm like, how often do you get the C-suite person down, motivating, encouraging, legitimately interacting beyond the perfunctory, like, hey, how are you today, like kind of thing? So this idea about how do people become great leaders, I think there has to be an idea of, first, the definition, what leadership really does mean, military terminology, how to influence and affect mm-hmm. people to do better things, versus, hey, look, he or she's a great leader because they make a lot of money, mm-hmm. you know, and they are on that, the hierarchy.
It sounds like you're talking about people who still can get down there and do the work
yep.
with their people. Is that it?
I think that there are, you know, a couple of dynamics. First of all, how they influence the atmosphere in which we spend all of our day away from our spouses. Like, somebody can make this a pleasant experience or a horrible experience. Like, that's one component of it. I think how this person might help us develop ourselves professionally is an impact of a good leader. I think somebody that ensures that not only do I understand my job, but that they understand their job, that's a component of leadership. Then there's all the, I don't want to say the superficial stuff, but the person that can be in front and speak in public in front of his or her troops and inspire them, that can communicate. So all those individual skills, I think all that kind of molds into this big lump of clay that we're calling the leader. And I actually, at the end of it, I believe anybody can do it.
You really do?
I do. I
you
absolutely
think some people do. Are just wired one way or the other?
I think that everybody has that ability that is just, nobody's worked hard enough for them or with them to get it out. And I say that, listen, I've seen the kids, and I don't want to sound so self-righteous about, gosh, you know, because I was an Army sergeant, I can do anything for anybody. But this idea that, you know, if you set the right conditions with the atmosphere, and if somebody, one, shows somebody what right really looks like, and then lets them fail at it and continually develops, they might not be, you know, the most poster child worthy person we know as a, what we say, leader, but they'll know how to do it in a crisis. And that's what really brings it back down. You know, in my opinion, we've got to have people that can get us through a crisis, because we have them all the time. And those that do, you know, are going to, we'll all look to them to get us out of it. And those that don't, we're like, you know, you're dead weight.
I had a boss once who said, he had a phrase and it's never left me. He said, who are you going to fall on your sword for? Who are you willing to fall on your sword for?
Yep.
I meet a lot of people who, I'm not falling on any sword for that person, but then you meet that one and you're willing to do whatever, probably because you know they do it for you.
Yep.
What's the power of that camaraderie in the business world, and why should we care about that?
Well, you know, in the, using, will be my little Ranger infomercial for a second. you know, in the Ranger Creed, which we say every day, everywhere in the world, some Ranger recites the Ranger Creed, there's a line that says, you know, and I will always endeavor to uphold the high esprit de corps of my Ranger regiment. You know, this idea that I will contribute every day to the greater good of this organization, and it absolutely becomes sacrosanct. I might not like you, we might not be best friends, but you can absolutely 100% rest assured that I will be here or I will die trying. I'm going to tell a story about that here, you know, a little later on. Understandably, we don't have crucible experiences, generally speaking, in the business world. But that piece of that
puzzle, which is a good thing.
But it's a relative, you know, I'm sorry, I didn't mean like, you know, bang. You know, it's a relative crucible. You know, how do we have a share of hardship? How do we get people that to really give a damn about the community, whatever that community is, unless they do it together? Which is really backing into this question about, you know, who do I fall on my sword for? Superficially, we'll do it for people that we know, we've seen, will do it for us. But that's got to be bolstered. That's got to be evangelized. People have to realize that institutionally, that is what we do here, which comes right back to the leadership, whether it is the noun or the verb. This is what we do all the time. This is how we, this is our values, this is our core, and I don't see it out here. You know, and I don't see it out here. I spent a lot of time thinking about why don't we see that here in general.
Are you talking about in American business right now in general?
Yep. I don't see those in the positions of influence, the leaders, that broadcast daily that we want to be, military term, the tip of the spear. We want to be the main effort. You know, when, you know, the Vince Lombardi world, you know, we, that literally we have to strive to be number one. Number two is not good enough. Somehow that's been distilled in general that we have just a whole lot of mediocrity. And I'm like, listen, I've seen it in the Army, which is an institution 500,000 men and women strong. You know, that they can uphold a standard higher than the average, than the norm. And within that, there are pockets of these units within the institution that can elevate to the highest of high standards always and operate. And I'm like, why can they do it there and we don't do it out here? And again, it does come full circle back to leadership. You know, the boss that says we are going to be on time always, you know, plus or minus 15 seconds. Like, that's the standard. High standards, we're going to be there.
Why are standards important? Because some people, devil's advocate, if my business is going along, my life is going along, my career is going along, some people are okay with okay.
Absolutely.
Why should we want more? Why raise the bar?
I think two reasons that I would give you my personal experience is, one, you know, we're all just one bullet away from failure. I mean, it just is. And again, not that I don't wish ill on anybody physically, but, you know, the bottom's going to fall out. Strategic shock. We're going to talk about it in an hour. Everything's just fine. Okay is good enough. The norm is good. Why should I do it? Leads to complacency. It leads us to dormancy. It leads us to inaction. And we're not, once we strive to not get better, we are going to start to deteriorate. I mean, I think that's smarter scientists could probably tell you why it happens.
But for now,
it's okay. You know what? I mean, we all like to take a break. And we're like, the last company I worked for, they used to say, you know, don't let perfection get in the way of good enough. And at first I'm like, well, that makes sense, you know, because we're doing so much, we, you know, it's good 80% solution, let's
go. Please tell me that wasn't like on a wall or something.
I hope not, boy, because I tell you, I'd go burn that place down. But it does, you know, you start telling people that have never don't have the wisdom maturity that okay is good enough, then it's like the TV commercial. Then we're just flatlined. But you know, it's a hard argument to make to somebody, particularly if you're if in business per se. Hey, you know what? We're making good dough. Our cash flow is good. Everybody's getting a bonus. You know, life is good. And you just say, well, what's behind the curtain? And let's look at 2008 and subprime credit default swaps. You know, I mean, again, not to be like gotcha, but that those things happen. And on the battlefield, if you're not looking to improve, you know, the enemy is. I mean, it really, you hate to be so cliche with military analogies, but, you know, it really, somebody's trying harder than you.
When you are talking to younger employees who hope to be those leaders, who will at some point, by default, be those leaders, what do you want them to hear? What do you want them to know?
You know, first of all, I without anything, doing anything else, civility is got to be number one. You know, the way we interact with each other has to be the most essential ingredient in anything you aspire to do. You have to be. Nobody wants to work for or with bad people. Oh, they're only going to do it for a little bit, and sooner or later, the money's going to not be enough to make me put up with this and my passion. So you have to treat people legitimately with dignity and respect always. Doesn't mean you can't discipline them. But, you know, so when I tell you, I used to tell some young lieutenants, young cadets when they were at West Point and young soldiers, in the Army, I'm like, if nothing else, when you show up on day one, look people in the eye, have a smile, and have a good handshake. That's it. You know, we know what you don't know because you're a brand new lieutenant or you're a brand new private, but, you know, we can sense your character, and they'll know that you have an interest in, you know, being a stand-up guy or gal. I will look them in the eye, and I will always be, you know, that kind of, you set the standard right there, that you are somebody that has a relationship. We can't be faceless and nameless and hide behind. I mean, you got to look people in the eye when they've done something wrong. But I think it all really does come back to civility and that idea of how we interact with each other.
What's one more? Be civil, and what's one more?
I think you have to be absolutely confident in one ability. And we all have one talent, you know, whether we're looking biblical or not, we have one talent, highlight it. You know, I used to always tell, again, in the Army side, where we're always judged by our physical fitness. Like, you know, you're a cadet at West Point, for instance, or any of the academies I use. You have 4 years to be really good at something. Push-ups, chin-ups, sit-ups, run, whatever it is. I'm like, you know, you can do it. So day one, after you shake their hand, smile, and say, we're going to go out and do chin-ups because I'm in charge, and do like 5 million chin-ups and, you know, let them all know that you mean business. Like that, you know, highlight your talent. And if you don't have one, you need to develop it. You know, we all got to be good at something, and we've got that. We've got it in our kit bags.
Well, you found a couple of things you're good at.
Well, you're very kind to say that, and you know, but you enjoy to share because we just it's a lot of average out here, and I don't mean to be so self-righteous about it, but there's just a lot of there's a lot of okay, and if you're somebody, and I believe that there really are a far greater amount of people that would love to be better than average, that they start to get frustrated and they're like, you know, they start jumping ship and like, you know, why is that? Well, they like to be pressed. They like to be challenged. They want to be, you know, people want to be on the winning team. And it's not that everything in life has got to be hyper competitive, but it's got to be like, you know, we'd like to be the best.
Matt, thank you very much. It's just a pleasure to meet you. Thank you.
Kind of let me suck up the oxygen today. Seriously. I appreciate it.
Thanks very much.
Wow. That don't be average stuff.
Mm-hmm.
I've been preaching that for a long time to no avail.
That's not true.
So I really wish that I could have been there for that.
You would have liked it, but I love that idea that, you know, just this idea of it's good enough. Once you start saying that out loud, you start believing it.
Yeah.
And I love what he said. You don't know when that moment's going to come, when the worst of the worst is going to happen. You better be ready.
And it's not good enough.
And it's not good enough.
Yeah.
It was a good conversation. I could have talked to him for another hour.
I bet you could have.
I know. Anyway, way, you can hear more of him because Matt actually hosts a podcast with his wife, Tori. It's called The Veterans Nation. You can catch that on Apple Podcasts. And then you can follow Matt on Instagram at Eversmann Advisory. So now to my least favorite part of this whole podcasting thing.
Please rate us.
Yes, that part. Can you take a minute? Would you please just go into like your Apple Podcast app? If you can rate or review us, it makes a big difference.
It does.
And we're starting to see some really good stuff, which we'll tell you about in some future episodes. So leave us a review. Please say something nice. We prefer you did. But we appreciate everybody who's been sharing it, reviewing it, and letting other people know about what we're doing with Dying to Ask. Very meaningful. Okay, can you stick around for the next episode?
No problem.
No vacations
Maybe.
Next time?
We'll see.
All right. Thanks for listening, and we'll see you next time on Dying to Ask.
Bye.